the rest of us, people who have synesthesia seem like they have superpowers, or at least super senses. They experience the world with one sense, like hearing a sound or smelling a scent, and then their brains automatically layer on a totally different sensation. One person might associate the name Philip with a bitter orange taste. Another might associate the word math with the color red. And they'd be right. Math is red, English is yellow, and science is green. Of course, simply having a preference for which notebook color you use in a class isn't the same thing as someone actually sensing the colors of letters, numbers, or words, even if it feels just as strong and personal. But it turns out that the human brain is wired in such a way that everyone has a form of synesthesia. Kinda. So in this episode, we'll explore 5 brain-bending ways all of us have senses that overlap. To help us make decisions, our brains combine information from all our sensory organs through a process called multisensory integration. Like, is that alarm and burning smell coming from my apartment building? Well, I don't see smoke, so it might be down the block. But this integration can get a bit messy because our senses can influence each other in predictable, repeatable ways. For example, your sense of smell can affect the taste of your food. These are known as cross-modal interactions, and some researchers consider them to be a weak form of synesthesia that we all share. Others, meanwhile, think it might be misleading to call these cross-modal interactions synesthesia because they're much less intense, and they're not necessarily automatic or simultaneous sensations. So with all that in mind, let's get into our first example, how your sense of hearing affects your sense of touch. Humans have probably been asking each other, does your body do this weird thing too, for millennia. But a lot of the formal scientific research was only published in the last few decades. And a 1998 paper was one of the first studies that documented a particular crossover between hearing and touch that they called the parchment skin illusion. The researchers had 17 adults rub their hands together in front of a microphone while listening to the sound of that hand rubbing through headphones. Sometimes the participants heard whatever the mic picked up. Sometimes they heard the same sound, but quieter. And sometimes they heard a version where the experimenters had adjusted just the high frequency portion of the sound profile, either cranking it up or down by 15 decibels. Of those 17 participants, 13 reported that high frequency sounds weirdly made their hands feel drier. Then, researchers repeated the trials with 11 of those subjects, asking them to rate the feeling on a scale of 0, meaning rough and moist, to 10, meaning smooth and dry. And despite the actual texture of their hands not actually changing, these 11 participants consistently reported that the louder and more high-frequency sounds made their hands feel more smooth and dry. Now, the authors of that study didn't really explain why they lumped smoothness and dryness together as one end of the scale, but both those adjectives describe paper, and presumably led to the catchy parchment skin illusion term. As for what's actually happening here, the skin of your palms and fingertips is packed full of sensory receptors, and there are specifically a lot of mechanoreceptors, which sense movement, stretch, or small vibrations. But you know what else senses vibrations? The hair-like mechanoreceptors in your inner ear that send signals to your brain so you can hear. Our brains combine hearing and touch information in regions like the caudomedial belt of the auditory cortex. So researchers think that when you hear and feel similar vibrations at the same time, subtle changes in what your ear detects can interfere with what you think your hands are feeling. But touch doesn't just have a special relationship with hearing. Your mouth is full of mechanoreceptors too. They help you feel the softness of a fresh peach or cereal scraping up the roof of your mouth.
I'm looking at you, Captain Crunch.
And chefs and sommeliers are onto something with the concept of mouthfeel, which is basically that a food's texture affects your dining experience. Because it turns out, there's a pretty strong cross-modal interaction between touch and taste. A 2015 paper tested this out by cooking an utterly luxurious recipe that called for a mixture of glucose syrup, vegetable oil, and citric acid, with either finely ground or coarse granulated sugar. Okay, those snacks are definitely more science experiment than fancy hors d'oeuvres, but they did their job. 2 basically identical foods with sweet, sour, and bitter ingredients. The only difference was one was smooth and one was rough. And when 38 participants ate these experimental snacks, they rated the smoother balls as tasting more sweet and the rougher balls more sour. The researchers also ran a second experiment where participants ate globs of a lemon curd-like gel that was served on either a smooth or textured plate. This was to see if just seeing a texture could influence your perception of sour, bitter, or sweet flavors. Turns out, it didn't, so this cross-modal link seems to be touch-related rather than sight-related. While touch and hearing seem to combine in the brain's auditory cortex, scientists think that the sensory information from touch and taste receptors combine in the orbitofrontal cortex. So that might be the neurological root of the crossover, but there could be some psychological aspects at play too. For instance, our brains are really good at learning patterns, like what textures and tastes to expect from the foods we're used to eating. Since you can eat all sorts of sour candies with those grainy citric acid crystals on top, your brain might automatically perceive more sourness in rough foods. Or there's this concept of hedonic match, which is basically the idea that our brain roughly groups pleasant and unpleasant experiences separately. Soft and sweet things are often perceived as enjoyable, while rough, sour, and bitter things are often, though not always, perceived as more uncomfortable. So these sensations may be associated in our brains and influence our perceptions of reality. What you hear can affect how your food tastes too, whether it's just the ambient noise of a restaurant or you're listening to your favorite playlist. A paper from 2011 had 48 participants eat different foods like chips, cheese, or cake with their eyes closed, and they had to rate the intensity of sweetness, saltiness, and whether they liked the food. But they also had headphones on and had to listen to either no sound, quiet white noise at around 50 decibels, or loud white noise at around 80 decibels. On average, all the foods tasted less sweet or salty when there was more background noise, but the participants didn't report that they enjoyed eating them any less. And by any, I of course mean by a statistically significant amount, which I took notes on in my red math notebook. One neurological explanation for this effect might be that when your brain processes all this noise, it could be distracted from processing the taste information. So instead of combining these sensory inputs, you're splitting your attention between two stimuli, and the taste feels less intense. But there are also cross-modal interactions between sounds and taste that can enhance certain flavors. In a 2017 study, 116 participants described the same kind of chocolate as tasting more or less creamy and more or less sweet, depending on the kind of instrumental music they listened to. If they listened to a flute slowly play a simple pattern, they were more likely to rate the chocolate as sweeter and creamier, at least compared to when they heard the sound of violins haphazardly plucking notes with clashing pitches. Marketing researchers have even gotten involved and branded this kind of cross-modal interaction as sonic seasoning, which, to be honest, is a much more catchy term. We think that sonic seasoning may have to do with that hedonic match concept I mentioned earlier. More specifically, there's a cognitive bias called the halo effect, where in this case, if you experience pleasant low-frequency sounds with your ears, your brain might extend that pleasantness to your taste buds by perceiving more sweetness.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. One of the best things about SciShow is that you can watch it anywhere with an internet connection. You can watch it all cozied up on your couch or on your phone when you're out and about. And Brilliant works the same way. Brilliant makes it easy to learn anywhere right on your phone with lessons you can complete whenever you have the time. And you have the time more places than you might think because Brilliant's lessons are just minutes long. You can learn on the go at brilliant.org/scishow, the QR code, or the link in the description. And that link gives you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get the first 30 days for free.
This next cross-modal interaction is a close cousin of what we were just talking about, because what you hear can also affect your sense of smell. In one experiment published in 2010, researchers gave 26 participants two chemical compounds to smell. One was rose-like and pleasant, called 2-phenylethanol, and one was sort of like Parmesan cheese and less pleasant, called 1-butanol. They were asked to rate how pleasant they found a certain smell after they listened to one of four different sounds through headphones: a baby laughing, a jazz drum, a baby crying, or a scream. The halo effect seemed to be involved here too, since the more enjoyable sounds made participants report both smells as more pleasant. And I think we all can sort of relate. It's hard to focus on anything good when you're listening to a scream. But the other main kind of experiment that researchers use to study this cross-modal interaction looks at the congruence of sounds and smells. In other words, what happens when you listen to sounds that make sense with what you're smelling versus something random. That 2010 paper had another experiment where they gave 22 participants either potato chip or coffee smells to sniff, while having them listen to a crunching chip sound, a gulping coffee sound, or white noise. We also came across a paper that gave 26 volunteers cinnamon and coffee as the smells, and a Christmas carol, a coffee commercial, or white noise as the accompanying sounds. These studies and others like them have found that perception of both the intensity and the pleasantness of odors increased when they matched participants' expectations. Neuroscientists don't have a strong sense of what's actually happening here, but our brains might be doing some kind of pattern recognition or recalling good memories, like the sounds and smells of a holiday. So this specific cross-modal interaction might depend on your lived experiences. Like if you don't celebrate Christmas, listening to a carol might not do anything to your perception of smell. A distinctive odor can be really evocative, from the warm temptation of a chocolate chip cookie to the stay away of a surprised skunk. And we're sticking with smell for our final example because smells can also affect how we see the world. A study from 1997 was one of the first to explore this cross-modal link. The research team used 5 different test smells, from a sugary caramel to leafy galbanum oil, and they mixed up 3 different intensities of each. Then 38 participants flipped through over 1,500 color chips to pick just one that visually matched what they were smelling. The team found that the general color family stayed consistent for each odor, like red-yellow hues for caramel. But the weaker versions of each odor were skewed toward lighter colors, and the stronger ones were matched to darker colors. Fast forwarding to 2023, a different team of researchers took this experiment to the next level by assigning their participants an achromatic adjustment task. The study had 24 participants sit at a computer while one of 6 scents was diffused into the room: caramel, cherry, coffee, lemon, and peppermint, plus water as a control. At the same time, they were instructed to use sliders on a computer program to change the color of a 500 by 500 pixel square so that it was a neutral gray. Compared to the color they picked while smelling water, the squares for all the scent trials were warmer in tone, with a different hue depending on the scent. Although, to be fair, the lemon and caramel could have been chalked up mathematically to randomness. But as an example, participants smelling cherry generally wound up picking a shade of gray that was actually very slightly red. Even the peppermint smell was red, despite the team's prior work that found an association between peppermint and blue-green color. This cross-modal interaction may be related to the idea of congruence, which this team called cross-modal harmony. Our brains might be trying to balance all the sensory information they receive by matching what we're seeing to what we're smelling. And what's weird is that might be the case even without us consciously knowing what the smells are, sort of like people with synesthesia experiencing the world. The participants were pretty bad at naming the odors. At most, 1/3 of them could guess the correct scent when presented with 26 possible options. But because of how they colored that digital gray square, there's still probably some underlying recognition or expectation. You know, I wonder what kind of cross-modal interactions would happen when smelling our Anubis candle available at complexly.store. How you perceive the world can be so subjective because your brain is doing the hard part automatically and unconsciously, whether you have synesthesia or not. So even if these cross-modal sensations aren't as otherworldly as tasting names, it's still pretty cool that you might enjoy a creamy dessert just a little bit more if you have some soothing music to listen to.